Warning. This video may contain some sensitive mental health topics that some of you may want to avoid watching. This is a very long video that is meant to be watched in parts. Don't forget to take breaks from YouTube if appropriate. Welcome to this highly personal series of videos about autism and how it affects my life. You are currently watching part 1. This is a very long video broken up into smaller parts to make it more watchable. Before you draw any conclusions or judge me, make actually sure to watch all of them in a chronological order, since it is meant to be watched that way. This is just the first part of part number 1. My name is Bart Coppens. And I have autism. Hi, Bart Coppens. I'm an autistic person. And I've never really talked about it in depth on my YouTube channel. For one reason. This channel is more about nature and butterflies and moths. And I don't like making highly personal videos that often. But I guess variety is the spice of life. And this is a subject that is important to me, so I decided to open up about it and thought maybe I can spread some awareness about this topic, which to me is very relevant and important. And if you are here to listen to me, then stay. It is going to be a highly personal video that includes some highly personal details. Now I understand what I upload on the internet, I cannot take it back. It's out there forever. It's like opening Pandora's box. So, what's going to happen with this highly personal information, some of which is actually very embarrassing or maybe even a little bit emotional? I don't know. I hope people will remain open-minded and respectful though, because talking about such things in front of an audience, it does make me nervous. But it is also an important topic, so let's get started. I was diagnosed with autism. I think I must have been like 15 or 16 years old, something in between that age. Here I actually have a document of what psychologists wrote about me, and I'm actually going to read some parts of it to YouTube, so it doesn't get more personal than that. Is this content? Yeah, it is now today, people. It's a bit crazy, I know, but hey, who cares? Life is short. And I'm not ashamed of who I am, so... And neither should you be. Maybe it will encourage some people who are watching this to open up about themselves too, you know? Don't be ashamed of who you are if it pertains to things that you really cannot control, right? I mean, be ashamed if your behavior hurts people and you are able to control the behavior, but don't be ashamed of your nature. It's what you're going to be stuck with for the rest of your life. Whether you hate it or love it or not, it's going to be there anyway, so you better get to accepting it instead, right? Most of the people who watch this channel will be aware that I'm extremely obsessed with insects, and in particular butterflies and moths. This particular quality of mine is not a result of social media. I was that way since I was born. And here's a fun fact about people with autism. People with autism commonly have preoccupations or special interests, which are peculiar subjects to which they obsessively and encyclopedically collect information. Now, if you look on the internet, you'll see many examples of such people. Autistic people obsessed with trains, airplanes, I don't know, Pokemon, like My Little Pony, Sonic. There's a lot of things that can fascinate us. Sometimes the subjects are more savory than others, but... Now, I have to say, this is not a symptom that every autistic person has to have. There are autistic persons who don't have such special interests, It's important to tell you this because sometimes it is a stereotype that every person with autism has to be like this savant who is very knowledgeable about one subject. That's not true. In fact, it is a harmful stereotype to those who don't have such preoccupations, right? Don't generalize it. But it is a common symptom. And for me, it is very intense, especially the obsession and the fascination with butterflies and moths. It has been there since I was, maybe 8 years old. And I discovered the caterpillars in my garden. But before that time, even as a baby, I tended to notice like insects, like I was pointing at ladybugs before I could speak. Now, before we dive into the autism thing, I thought it would be fun and cool to share with you some personal things because let's say that psychologists or psychiatrists have evaluated my mind thoroughly at a younger age, and they wrote some pretty funny stuff about me, some of which is still relevant today. Please keep in mind this document was made over 12 years ago, maybe even longer. I think I was 15, 16 at the time. Right now I'm 28, so that's a long time. And some of these aspects of my personality may have changed, but many of them are still relevant. So this is a video about autism and how it works in the brain and awareness. But before we start that, I also want to just to talk a little bit about myself and the way it affects me. So here's what they had to say about me. This is a description of me made by other people. In our intelligence research, it appears that Bart's capabilities are of an average level and has a TIQ, total IQ, of about 100. That's pretty average, right? The verbal comprehension index is an index that measures the ability to form verbal concepts, verbal reasoning, and knowledge that is gained from the environment. On this index, Bart achieved a score on a gifted level. VBI is 127 with a 95% reliability interval of 120 to 132. So that is funny. What this says is that I have a pretty average IQ, about 100 IQ. 100 is pretty much the median. But some aspects of my intelligence, they are on a more on a gifted level. And I'm not saying that to brag or show off. But when it comes to like my deductive reasoning and my verbal capabilities, my IQ is in the range of 127, which is on the higher side. However, when it comes to other functions, such as spatial awareness, my IQ is around 90. So there's a discrepancy in my IQ, and maybe we'll get to that later in the video, but some parts of my brain are highly developed, while others are underdeveloped. And that's why it's possible for me to score on a gifted level on some aspects of an IQ test, but have an average IQ of 100, because I score very below average on other aspects. So if you have high IQ and low IQ at different cognitive functions, then the average will be in the middle. And that's really one curiosity about me. So what it means is that my verbal reasoning and my deductive reasoning are very high. So what that means for me, I don't know. It means that I'm good at talking, I'm good at convincing, I'm good with language and words, you know, debating. So, and maybe that's something you can see on this channel as well, by the fact that English is not my native language at all, but I am quite fluent at it, but also at the fact I'm good at storytelling, reasoning, making long videos, entertaining people, talking about things that interest me, that ties into this as well. Oh, now here it starts to get funky. It is immediately noticeable that Bart possesses an extensive vocabulary, but now and then he has the habit of losing the essence of his story. About his hobby, or as he himself calls it, his preoccupation, he can talk extensively without realizing he's losing the interest of his listener. He has to be calmed down or inhibited, or he will continue endlessly. While Bart does respond to the questions he has been asked, he is endless in his answers and uses convoluted language. In this moment, Bart does not adjust himself well. He shows us pictures on his mobile phone of butterflies, caterpillars and crickets. I can't believe I did that to the psychologist, wow. When it comes to social interaction, Bart is easygoing and friendly. Bart responds quickly to instructions, sometimes too quickly, because he tends to respond with questions that reveal he hasn't been paying attention. Sometimes the instructions have to be repeated. From time to time, Bart fidgets with his clothes or objects on the table. Sometimes he appears to be confused because he didn't hear or understand something properly. Especially during the start of our research, he tends to repeat the questions from our researchers out loud. That's funny. What this means is that they were trying to talk to me, but I was constantly distracted, fidgeting with objects, and constantly talking about my hobby, which is butterflies and moths. Now, you should know that this was a long time before I started this YouTube channel. Because nowadays, you know, you could argue that when I talk about butterflies and moths, I'm getting something out of it. I kind of monetized it by starting a YouTube business, right? So you could say that, well, Bart has something to gain from it by talking about these animals. That's true. But here is the proof that this is not where the behavior stems from. I've been like this pretty much since I was very young. If I didn't have a YouTube channel, I would still be the same. I would just be talking to someone else who wouldn't be interested instead. All my life, I kind of tended to bore people with my stories about insects. And for that, actually, I'm very happy to have found YouTube as a platform. It made my life better, but it also gave me an outlet for this energy, you know? I need to talk about these animals constantly. If I don't, I probably go crazy. Problem is, it drives most people away, but it doesn't drive you away. That's why you are here. So I guess it is both a curse and a talent, so... So now let's move on to the next segment. By the way, most of this is in Dutch, right? So I translated it. It's an English translation of what they wrote about me in Dutch. So let's move on to the next segment. The client can passionately talk about his hobby of breeding butterflies and moths. He shows us photos on his mobile phone and then shows us pictures of butterflies and moths. In these moments, Bart doesn't adjust to his listener very well. Bart doesn't respond to the questions of our psychiatrist anymore, and when she tries to ask him a question, he can interrupt her only to proceed with his own story. And then he talks continuously. Yeah, that sounds like me. The good news is due to social media being popular online, I've had to interact and meet with a lot of strangers. I've gotten to travel the world. I have to say, since then, it's gotten a little bit better. But I still have the problem of where I don't listen when people ask me questions or try to interject. But instead, I'm focused on finishing my own story, right? I have something on my mind, and I selfishly have to get the story out without listening to what the other people have to say in return. It's gotten better, but I still catch myself doing it from time to time. And that's the fact that I guess that I'm someone who likes to hear themselves speak, especially when it's about subjects that interest or fascinate me, just repeating them out loud. It's like I'm my own audience in some way, you know. Sometimes when I'm telling a story to someone else and they aren't really interested, I still enjoy talking about it because I'm just enjoying listening to the story I'm processing myself. Which sometimes makes me a selfish person to have a conversation with, because at times I seem to be quite disinterested in what the other person has to say. It's a personality flaw of mine. Anyway, all of this stuff is really just mild. Some of the really bad things that I struggle with due to autism, I'm going to reveal this in this video. But I thought this would be a good way to open up the video. Now, from a very young age, I was very preoccupied with insects, and this does tie into autism. Now, disclaimer, you don't have to be autistic to like insects. You don't have to be autistic to be obsessed with insects, right? There's plenty of normal people. I don't like to use the word normal. There's plenty of neurotypical people. I don't like to use that word either. I will tell you that later. There's plenty of people who don't have autism that still like insects and are obsessed by them. There's a lot of people who pursue entomology who don't have autism and are good at their work. But I think there is a correlation between the fact that people with autism have autistic preoccupations that make them obsessed with certain subjects, which tend to be very peculiar, logical subjects that kind of make sense, such as, well, it's usually technical stuff or something pertaining to science, but animals, biology, and insects are a common one. So I'm in the entomology community online, and let me tell you, I've met dozens of people like me who are also autistic and also have a big fascination for something like insects. It's actually quite common. So I thought that would tie into this very neatly, and it would give me some insight, give you some insight into my mind and how it really works as a person. So yes, ladies and gentlemen, me and insects are a funny subject. And the relationship I have with insects is pretty intimate and goes very deep. In some way, they are an extension of myself. Clearly, as you could have seen in the psychology report that I just read, or some of the pictures I've shown of my childhood, me and insects are very intertwined. And my obsessive tendency to document them, talk about them, and really enjoy them on an emotional level, because that's what it is, you know? Insects, they give me a lot of emotions that I rarely feel in other situations. Like, they can really give me intense happiness and fascination. To me, it's more than just enjoying something beautiful, it's something emotional. And I think this is one of the aspects of my autism that has actually helped me become successful in many ways. For example, my whole online thing where I talk about insects on YouTube, on social media. All of that is kind of a business that helps sustain me and my lifestyle. It helps fund some of my research projects. It has helped me become successful, right? But in this video, I don't just want to focus on the aspects of autism that have made me successful. I also want to open up about the aspects of autism that kind of ruined my life once in a while. And those are the things that I haven't talked about, because me and the weird insect thing, I mean, that's kind of very well known knowledge at this point. But some of the stuff behind the scenes that I struggle with, you know, the part of autism that doesn't help me become successful, but actually stands in the way of my success and makes my life more troublesome and frustrating and sad. Because behind the scenes, that is happening from time to time. And those are the things I also want to talk about, the bad things that I suffer from. So yeah, let's get started about that. Warning. Now, this was the more lighthearted, the more wholesome and fun part of it. But this video is going to get dark in places. Maybe even depressing or triggering for some people to watch. If you don't like seeing dark stuff that is about mental health, don't watch this video. If you want to listen to me and see what my life is like and the things I struggle with, then please continue. The problem with social media is that it's very easy to portray yourself as somebody who has a flawless life, right? Many people feel as if they personally know the people they watch on YouTube or even form friendships with them. But what do you really know about me? What do you really see? Do you know the things I struggle with behind the scenes? The answer is no. Not until I decide to share them. On YouTube, I'm often happy. I often pretend like things are going well. And that's part of the show. It's not a lie. It's just that personal stuff is inappropriate in most of my videos, which are just about nature. And it's my choice not to share them. So it's not like me withholding information from you because you are not entitled to that information in the first place. I can decide to share personal things with you or not. But the truth is that I am not always the happy person you see on YouTube, that my life is difficult, and that I have mental health struggles from time to time. And it's hard. It's hard to deal with. And now I'm going to get in some parts of the things, in many of some of the ways that autism affects me that are not nice, that are not pretty, that are not like, oh, Bart likes to play with butterflies and that makes him wholesome. It's not always wholesome. It can be a struggle. So without further ado, let me tell you what I struggle with. And I have to pull up my phone to give you the exact definition of this, which is important because I don't want this to be misrepresented. But I have problems with my executive functions. What are executive functions? Let me explain. I have here the definition. An executive function is a set of mental skills that include working memory, flexible thinking, and self-control. We use these skills every day to learn, work, and manage daily life. Trouble with executive function can make it hard to focus, follow directions, and handle emotions, among other things. And some examples of executive functions are proficiency in adaptable thinking, planning, self-monitoring, self-control, working management, working memory, time management, and organization. The point is, my mind is an utter, utter chaos. It's like a hurricane in here. It's like a storm is raging. For me, it's very, very hard to plan, to keep things under control. I'm really bad at planning an organization to such a way it almost makes me unable to work, to study, to find a normal job or a career. Yeah, that's pretty heavy. I know, it's pretty hard. I know it sounds kind of... Maybe some of you who watch this channel would have expected it. Maybe some of you would have not. Maybe some of you think that I seem to be a very intelligent and functioning person, but it's very far from the truth. That's only the surface that you see on YouTube. Behind the scenes, I'm someone who struggles to survive in this society. I'm going to show you some of the ways in which it impacts me in my life. I'm going to start with the most, with the less serious ones, and then build up to the more serious ones. Let me show you what I mean in this part one of the chaos in my mind. Thank you. La 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 la. I am just an autistic boy living an autistic life. Do 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 do. Hi sir, you want me to pay for my bus ticket? Of course, let me grab my wallet. Where's my wallet? Guys, I can't afford my bus ticket. I'm stranded. Let me call my mom to pick me up. Let me get my phone. Where's my phone? Hey. Before you guys say that my acting skills need work, did you know that I actually acted in a movie? That's right. I played the role of Icarus, but instead of feathers, I glued moths to my arm. Let me show you, it was actually acting in a movie. Yeah, it was a tiny art film, but it was still interesting and I got paid well for it. The producers found me such an interesting person, me with my autism and my moths and my fascination, that they wanted to cast me in the role because they liked me as a person. Because I'm weird and quirky and artsy and they thought that I belong in a film. So, don't worry about my acting skills, okay? It's usually not that bad. But I think I'm derailing the conversation, you see. What I just showed you was what happens quite frequently in my life. Like all of us probably struggle with losing our stuff once in a while. But have you ever gone on vacation and realized you forgot your passport? Have you ever traveled the world to film insects but you forgot your SD card for your camera? Have you ever went to the bus or train and realized that halfway through you forgot your train or bus ticket? My identity card, which is sort of like a passport in the Netherlands, is called an identity card. I've lost it so many times that if I lose it again, they'll put me on a watch list for identity card fraud. Because I lose the card and request a new one so frequently, they're suspecting I'm selling illegal IDs at this point. Probably in the past 10 years, I've lost it probably 3 or 4 times. I've lost my bank card, I think over 6 or 7 times. I've lost my train card over 5 times, had to request a new one. These people are earning a lot of money for me ordering a brand new card. Now, some of this stuff might sound funny, it may sound silly and relatable, but it's not. Sometimes it's to the point where it's life ruining. And the underlying issue is my inability to organize and plan. And this really pertains also to the organization and planning of my own items. My ability to not lose them, you know, to not accidentally drop them or leave them somewhere. But it extends to many other aspects of my life as well. But let me tell you some other things and shenanigans I've done over the past few years. Managing to lock myself out of the house when my parents were gone for a whole day. So I had to kick one of the doors in to get back into my house, or I would have to sleep on the street. So I really kicked in a window to go back into my own house. I paid for the repair, but my parents were very angry. Leaving the house and leaving, for example, the gas or the stove on, which is very dangerous, it could start a fire. I'm capable of doing stuff like that. Or also just when I leave my house, leaving the door unlocked. That means that if somebody breaks into your house and steals all your stuff, it's not insured, right? Like, it's only burglary if people forcefully break into your house. If you leave the door open and they enter, you're not gonna get compensated for the damages, and it's really stupid. I'm capable of doing things like that constantly. Taking the wrong train, taking the wrong bus, mistaking the wrong day and the wrong week and the wrong month. Now, it all sounds really funny and clumsy, you know, haha, clumsy Bart. But if it happens constantly, it gets to the point where you struggle, or you struggle to function like a normal person. And that's what I experience from time to time. It's really just the chaos in my mind. I cannot easily prioritize things, right? Like, if you fry an egg, right, for your breakfast, most people will remember to turn off the stove, right? The what do you call it in English? The stove, right? That's the right word. You don't leave it on, that's obvious. But such an obvious and important detail for me can be low on my list of priorities, so low that I forget about it. This because my brain really has problems prioritizing and remembering certain types of information. So often I will have to manually repeat it for myself or make a checklist for myself so I don't forget anything. For example, if you go to the airport and you want to catch a flight to another country, you're gonna need your passport, right? So you take your passport to the airport. Who is capable of forgetting such an important detail? Guilty, I am. I would be very capable of forgetting something crucial if it is something really trivial. And that's because our brains, when we are always doing and thinking certain things at the same time. And I guess our brain mentally makes like a checklist. It puts them in order of importance. But for me, somehow this often goes wrong. This also results in me often losing my stuff. As I showed you, I dramatically dropped my wallet in the intro of this video. Like, oh no, guys, where's my wallet? I don't know. Oops, I just dropped everything on the floor. But, it may sound a little bit silly the way I show it on YouTube, but the way it happens in real life is not silly. It's just sad and aggravating. Have you ever lost your wallet and all your freaking cards in it? It's not a nice feeling. It's a terrible feeling. You'll be out of an identity card. You'll be out of like a bank transaction card. You'll be helpless for a few weeks until you receive all your cards. And I've been through that several times in my life, just losing important stuff. You know, when I was young, I actually worked for a famous university in the Netherlands doing data transcripts for phonetic language research. And all my work of 2 months, I put it into one USB stick. And 1 week before the deadline, I was finished. And somehow I couldn't find my USB stick. Man, I was almost at the point of screaming and crying until like one day before the deadline. I was in my garden and I randomly saw the USB stick there, like in a bush. I don't even know how it got there. I must have gone outside with my camera to film insects or something and it slipped out of my pocket. I retrieved it and thankfully it wasn't damaged by the rain. Like, I could have lost my job back then. It was so stressful and it's like that anxiety, you know, when I go on a big trip or travel, yeah, I'm excited, but I'm also anxious because of the many things that can and do go wrong. I'm remembering going to the UK once, where I was supposed to go to Attleboro, but I took the train to Attenboro. Seems that there's two different places. I know that sounds like a rookie mistake. It's even a mistake a person without autism could make, I agree. But I make these mistakes just way more frequently than any more normal person would. So I even have to take medication for it. I'll show that later. Right now it's methylphenidate. It improves my concentration. But it sucks. It feels like I'm constantly fighting against my own brain to get things right, you know? I have to make checklists and stuff, so, because I cannot trust my instincts. And it's a horrible feeling to not be able to trust your instincts, because that's all that you have in a in a difficult situation, right? When you are in a tough spot in life, your instincts are really what save you from distress most of the time. For me, it's the opposite. My instincts are what brings me distress, is what brings me further trouble. I should not listen to them. So yeah, I hope that you guys, that despite the fact that this is a lighthearted story, the way it affects me is certainly not lighthearted. I can laugh about it, I can joke about it, but it's really not fun, it's terrible. It's a disability. And it's not something I can really visually show very well to my audience. You'll just have to imagine how it feels like, you know? I'm also very bad with tools. Me and my best friend once had an apartment in a city called Utrecht, where I lived for, well, about 1 year with my best friend. And he always had to open the door for me because I couldn't figure out how to open the door lock with my key. It usually took me about 20 minutes to enter my own house using my front door key. That sounds bizarre and ridiculous, but imagine being so blind to the uses of tools and spatial awareness that opening a door with a key can be troublesome for you in some circumstances, that you just can't figure it out. And every time I would have the same problem, like it didn't improve. How about driving lessons? I don't have a driver's license because I am terrible at driving cars. I've had over 60 driving lessons, and I barely made any progress. I forget to look at signs, I start ghost driving against traffic. Sometimes I mistake the gas pedal for the brakes. If I were to drive a car more often, I would probably kill myself. Not on purpose, but like, my brain works in such a way that I could just ignore a red light. Or I don't know where to go on the lanes. It's confusing, all these stripes, all these signs, it's overwhelming. So I go against traffic on the highway. I actually did that. So until my instructor started screaming and rammed on the brakes. So it's starting to look like I won't be driving a car anytime soon, which is also crippling, you know? Thankfully, I live in a country with excellent public transport. But what if I want to be independent, if I want to work a job that's far away? Most people commute to their work with their car. I wouldn't be able to do that. It's already a massive restriction, you know, on my freedom, on my work opportunities and stuff. Already, it's more difficult. It limits where I can work and study, if you have to take public transport everywhere. What if you want to travel the world like I do? Like you want to do biology, film rare butterflies and moths? You're not gonna get everywhere with a freaking bus or train. So it's just things like that, small things like that that add up. But when you combine them, it makes me really somebody who is not independent. I'm very dependent on people helping me most of the time. People driving me around or helping me plan stuff. When I'm alone, things can really go wrong. So that makes me feel like a big child in many ways and helpless, and it sucks. Then again, I am working to find solutions to these problems. I've gotten better over the years. You know, when I was young, it was really terrible. I guess there is some plasticity and, you know, with trial and error, if you practice something a lot, even if you're bad at it, you will get better at it. I will never get good at it, but I will get better at it, you know. If I use my wallet one time a year instead of three times per year, or maybe once every 2 years, that would be a great improvement, you know. It's just stuff like that. Executive functions, they suck. And it also affects my concentration. How that changed my life, let me tell you this right now. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you about one of the other things, one of the other ways in which autism has negatively affected my life. Since I was very young, since I was, it must have been like 10 years old, my parents and teachers asked me, Bart, what is it that you want to do later in your life? What do you want to become when you grow up? My answer was always an entomologist. I always wanted to do entomology. So even when I was very young, can you imagine a child wanting to be an entomologist? That's crazy, right? That's how I was. So how did that go? How did that career go? Well, at the beginning it was a complete failure, I have to say. In fact, I went to college twice. And I failed twice. It turns out that due to my terrible executive functions, I'm so bad at planning. I'm so bad at finding motivation and concentration and sticking to one certain thing at a time, that academically I'm quite a bit of a failure. I really struggled at college. And it was autism really played a large role in this. In the fact that I had learning difficulties. For example, every time that I had an exam or a test, I would start studying for it like 2 or 3 days in advance. Which is arguably very stupid, right? But for me, it was really just an inability to plan and organize and consistently study a little bit every day, because that requires a high degree of foresight and planning. And it's really that foresight that I lack, these executive functions. Now, this was really frustrating because I feel like I am capable of understanding much of the subject matter. So I don't have an intellectual disability, okay? My intellect is quite capable of understanding some higher level concepts pertaining to biology and environmental sciences. But at the same time, I have a weird disability that prevents me from learning and studying. I'm constantly distracted, I'm disorganized, and something as simple as reading a book is just very hard for me. It's very hard for me to stick to one thing and continue doing it, if you understand what I mean. And I guess that the word that I'm looking for here is the word persistence. Do I lack persistence? Strangely, in some ways, I'm extremely persistent. Just look at my YouTube channel. I've uploaded over 1,000 moth videos in 7 years' time, some of which are hours long. So in that, I would say, I would describe myself as an extremely persistent person, right? But when it's something that I guess I am not obsessed about, like moths, like, I don't know, it could be something like chemistry, which you do have to learn chemistry if you want to be a biologist. Organic chemistry is very important. So, but with that subject, I'm slightly less obsessed. And thus it becomes more difficult to really persist, you know, to be motivated to do it constantly. I am very distracted. I often pursue instant gratification. And on top of that, I get overwhelmed. And you have to do college courses and read literature a little bit every day. That requires a level of planning that I don't think I have it in me. And that was really disappointing, because my dream of becoming an entomologist was kind of crushed in a way. But also it wasn't, because I guess that in some ways I did become an entomologist. But the way I became one was very strange, and it was through social media. Let me show you here. I don't know if you can see it from there. But this, you know what this is? This is a scientific article about insects that I published myself. It's something I'm very proud of. I guess I could say that I officially described something and published it in scientific literature. It's not much It's basically the detailed description of the life cycle of a moth species. I'm not going to go into detail. So it's not rocket science, it's not something super complicated like genetics or organic chemistry or phylogeny or evolutionary history. It's a very simple paper, but I'm proud of writing and publishing a paper in the first place as someone who doesn't have a college degree and who didn't have it in him to finish a college degree. To me, it proves I, under rare certain circumstances, I am capable of learning. I am capable of discovering things and describing them using the scientific method on a scientific level. And I am, by many people, I am regarded as an entomologist. Although you could call me, I guess you should call me an amateur entomologist. I know amateur sounds bad, but amateur basically means someone who doesn't have an academic background, but is involved to some extent in research. I would love to do more complicated things in my life. It's still one of my dreams. But before I do that, I have to get over this obstacle, this barrier. Much of it really ties into autism. For example, I tried finishing books, I tried reading books to practice my concentration and my persistence, but I struggle to read more than 20 pages of one book a day, just because like after 1 hour, my mind will start racing. It will start thinking about other things that I want to do. Maybe I will think about something like YouTube, or I will start reading my text on my smartphone, my WhatsApp, or my Instagram, or YouTube, and I will check my statistics, and suddenly I'm reading Facebook or Reddit, and I'm completely distracted. I know it sounds trivial, a little bit funny even, a little bit hilarious, like, haha, we all struggle with concentration. That's true, I think every average person who wants to study struggles with concentration. But I struggle with it so much, it becomes pathological. It becomes to a point where I struggle to function at work and struggle to function in college. And I'm gonna be honest, I wish there were more programs in entomology for people like me. Autism is very complex because every person with autism is different and the things they struggle with are very different on an individual basis. It's less generalized compared to other mental issues. There's more variability, more individuality, and that makes generalized programs not very effective for every person with autism. Now, there's nothing that I love more in my life than life sciences and biology and entomology. I love it, like, I love this stuff. So that makes it pretty ironic that I have issues that prevent me from learning the thing that I love. It feels weird to be intellectually curious as someone who has a learning disability, right? Imagine this. You are intellectually curious and you want to learn everything about a certain topic, but you have certain learning disabilities that hold you back from studying. You want to learn, you want to study, but in many ways you can't. You are prevented from doing it. That's how I feel. But I haven't really given up yet, although I do have the problem of slowly becoming older. If you are young and passionate and you're like, you know, I have autism and I struggle with learning and I want to do entomology, sometimes a nice professor will pick up on that and will say, well, maybe I will mentor you, I will help you, I will give you some resources to so you can try and learn. But who wants to invest in a 28-year-old man, right? I'm a little bit washed up at this point, and I often feel like it's too late for me to study or pick up a career. Now, one thing is that it's funny is that maybe I am one of the very few entomologists in the world who achieved it through social media. Actually, soon I'm going to the Atlantic rainforest in Brazil, in South America, and study the local moth fauna there. I'm going to make a registry of the local Saturnidae species. I'm slowly developing a website about all the Saturnidae in the world, their distribution, their evolutionary history. I can do things like that. That's crazy. And it's actually YouTube that helped me get there, you know? Because after I failed in college, I worked in a warehouse in a factory for 7 years. It was the worst time in my life. But it was the popularity of my videos, the popularity of the articles I published, the popularity of, well, my videos. People love to follow the things that I do. I managed to monetize it. And because of that, I was able to get a job. I got jobs in natural history museums. I got jobs in butterfly farms. I got to work together with actual entomologists. You can see all of that on my channel if you want to prove. And now soon I'm going to be an actual entomologist, an actual researcher who is going to study moths in the Atlantic rainforest in Brazil. And I'm very proud of that. And it's very weird and unusual how I managed to do this through the internet and social media instead of going to university. Despite that, I haven't made it yet because I don't have a formal degree. There's still many very complex concepts like barcoding, which is very relevant for the taxonomy of certain animals that I love, that I can't really fully comprehend or understand. And I'm going to be honest, it makes me feel dumb. It makes me feel stupid. I wish I could get a degree and I could become so educated as some other people are that I have seen, you know, just to get a basic grasp of things like genetics and evolution. Now, I know the basic outline of this, but I don't know the really in-depth information that I would love. And I've tried to find a solution for this, but it's still far away, you know. I went to many doctors and psychiatrists, and most of the time their solution is like, Bart, why don't you take some pills? Medicine has played a differentiating role in my life. There's been years I've not been on medication. There's been years that I have been on medication. I've been on many types of medication in my life too. Some of them have a limited ability to improve my concentration, such as this, what's this stuff called? This is methylphenidate. It's basically like meth, right? It's like meth, but a lighter form of it. Here, let's take one. It's very tasty. What this stuff does is it improves your mood. It improves your concentration. It also completely destroys your sleep cycle. Don't take this stuff if you want to sleep. It will just keep you awake. Yummy. Blah. Emotionally, it also makes you a very distant zombie, especially after the drug has worn off. Because it tends to improve your mood at first, right? It kind of makes you more social at first. It kind of makes you a little bit more engaging, more happy. But when it wears off, it's kind of, after the high, there is a low, and the low is lower than the high. It kind of like drains your energy. And if you take this medication after one day, you just feel emotionally very flat and exhausted. So unfortunately, I have to take this garbage to even function in my life, probably. Otherwise, I just become more disorganized and forgetful. It sucks. It really sucks. Thing about autism, there is not really a pill that you can take to relieve all the symptoms. There is some medication that can relieve some of the symptoms, like your concentration or maybe improve some sensory issues, but there is no cure. You just have to learn to live with it and your disability. So yeah, this is my little venting video. Probably not many people are going to watch this because it's going to be extremely long and convoluted. And nobody really wants to hear a 3-hour story by some guy on YouTube they don't really care about. This video is also for me because I like to vent about this once in a while. But maybe there's a small handful of people who followed me over the years, and this video will help you explain something about who I am behind the scenes and some of my life story. One of my greatest dreams and ambitions, though, in life is still find a way to study. I don't know if it's possible or how. Just find a way to study and get a degree, because it would open up so many doors for me, you know? I'm a successful YouTuber with a successful entomology channel who managed to get into entomology with a degree. Now imagine what I could do with a degree. Imagine if I was an entomologist with a degree and a popular YouTube channel and who could research independently. I would be on top of the world if I could achieve that, but I don't know if that's possible. That's like the best of both worlds, right? You'll be an educated biologist with a massive audience. That's living the dream. But I'm lacking the educated biologist part. So yeah. Now, I'm a very science-aligned person. I love science. I love reading about it. But I really struggle to force myself to read or study things that in some way I don't want to, right? Like, my brain is a very easy and lazy brain. My brain wants instant gratification, and it doesn't really have the commitment to, you know, my concentration will be broken if I have to commit to something that I don't like studying something boring. Everybody has to study something boring, even if your study is interesting. When you're doing biology, you also get to do things like statistics and maths. It's not as fun as things like evolution to me. I'm not into it, but it's part of the same study, but it's more boring to me. And that's when I really lack like the commitment that I need. It's like my brain doesn't remember anything that it doesn't want to remember. Like, it just rejects most of the information it takes in, unless it has to do with some of my tunnel vision interest, which is just moths, 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 moths. That's all my brain wants to know. It's about moths and nothing else. And it kind of ruins my life in many ways. It's hard for me to find a normal job, the way I function, the way this brain works. The very low level of commitment that I have, low commitment, low motivation, low planning and organization, terrible executive functions. But there is light at the end of the tunnel. I'm still faithful that one day I will pick up the pieces and understand how this brain works and how I can exploit it and get where I want to be in life. But until then, I'll just be complaining on YouTube. So yeah. Anyways, we started talking about some of the more lighthearted stuff. So now we are at more serious stuff. The stuff that prevents me from being a functioning human in society, from finding a job, from having a career, filling my dreams. But now I'm about to show you really the worst thing that I struggle with. And it is my utter lack of planning and organization in my life. I really struggle to keep things organized sometimes, and when things overwhelm me, I just lose control. Like, I can neatly arrange this stuff, right? I can organize these books here, look. Wow, guys, I organized these books into a nice pile, right? But if you ask me to do this every day and keep them organized, you know, that's when I would have a problem. My life is really a mess when it comes to being on time for things, planning things properly. There's many things that slip my mind that are like, that come naturally to people, like closing the door before I leave my house. I could leave my house and leave the door open in some cases. I could leave the stove on after cooking something. And frankly, Sometimes when there are so much things that I have to plan and do at the same time, I just drop all of it and I stop doing it. It fluctuates with my mood. I have good times and bad times. But I'm about to show you one of the bad times. And how I'm going to show you that? By showing you my bedroom. You see, the lack of organizing also comes to organizing my stuff and my items. I have an overwhelming amount of stuff. And what I'm about to show you is what it looks like when my mental health is bad. When I'm down, when I'm depressed, when I'm going through a bad moment in my life and I drop things. I'm going to show you what my bedroom can look like. Just as an example, the problem is not my bedroom, but it's a nice way to visualize the extreme chaos that I have to constantly deal with in my mind. What you're about to see is bad, it's embarrassing, it's humiliating, it's personal. Okay, I'm not proud of it, I'm very ashamed of it, and it's difficult to show it to my audience who sees me positively. They may think of me negatively after showing this, they will think I'm gross or a freak. But you have to see the truth, you have to see the part of me that I am. Check out my bedroom. It's funny because on YouTube I always seem so happy. And it's not an act. In those moments I am genuinely happy. Thing is that that's not always me. The truth is that it's sometimes hard to talk about. Sorry, I don't want to be one of those influencers who is crying for clout or for internet credits. And it's not that I'm unloved. Clearly there's a lot of people who care about me. It's just that it makes you feel so different, man. Like this society isn't made for you. So you know what I mean? I'm sorry for crying on YouTube. That's a new low for me. It's funny because I'm always so happy in my videos. And I want you guys to know that's not an act. In those moments, I am genuinely happy. There is a lot of happiness in my life. There are a lot of people who care about me. But despite all of that, there are a lot of problems. And the thing is, those problems are hard to solve for me, you know? Because I realize the problem is me. It doesn't matter where I go, what country I move to, what job I have. Those problems are a part of who I am. I cannot escape them. I cannot cure them. I cannot heal them. They are me, for all it's worth. I know people are probably going to make fun of this. I don't care. Thing is, on YouTube, I like to share my genuine emotions, the way I actually feel in the moment. That includes laughter, and sometimes that includes tears. Life is not always that special show, that positivity that we share with others on YouTube. Life is all sometimes also crap. And that's the thing, man. But today I'm sharing with you the crap, because I shared all my happy moments with you. But sometimes I'm allowed to share the crap. It's just hard, you know? Just feels like you see all these other people around you, and everything they do, it just comes naturally to them. Things that you struggle with, that just come naturally to them. Makes you feel like something is wrong with you. Let's be honest, there is something wrong with me. That doesn't mean I'm a bad person. Doesn't mean I'm being harsh on myself. It means I'm just being honest. So, clearly, I have my reasons for not talking about this very much. I will tell you more about it later, but clearly there is not always sunshine. Sometimes there is also a lot of rain. If you catch my drift. I'm going to be honest. The older I get, the more concerned I am for myself and my own future. Thinking about it is terrifying. I don't know what it's going to look like. It's just so weird being this popular online. Well, people, they tend to look up to you on YouTube. And I'm like, how? How can you look up to such a loser like me? It's so weird, because people, they idolize you, because they only see your good parts on YouTube, and they have no idea what's going on in your life behind the scenes, you know? Sometimes I get like emails from little kids who are watching this channel with their parents, and they're like, oh, little Timmy, he's a big fan of you and your channel, and he wants to grow up like you and that. Those kind of things. See, I'm smiling again, because it makes me happy. That kind of stuff makes me happy, but it also gives me these weird mixed feelings, like, how can you look up to a 27-year-old living with his parents? It's because you don't know. You don't know what's going on. I'm not trying to devalue myself. I know that I have my accomplishments. My self-worth, I have self-esteem. But I also know that a lot of the image that people have of me is not realistic. And somehow that hurts. That's one of the reasons I'm making this video. It takes a lot of courage to upload something like this to potentially 20,000 subscribers, which I have at this point, who could see me in a vulnerable position that not many people have seen me in. And I'm actually very anxious about uploading it. I'm thinking about deleting it, but I know I'm going to upload it. I just want to be honest, just for once in my life, for one time. And I think that also that there is strength in showing your emotional side. In fact, I am not afraid of being vulnerable at moments like these. It makes no sense to live your life dictated by others, trying to keep up appearances, trying to be strong. I think there is more strength in being able to show your vulnerability. But yes, it is very weird. It's very hard to think about. On YouTube, I smile a lot. But you have to realize that behind my smile, there is sometimes also sadness and struggles. Don't get me wrong. My life is not bad. I'm overall a very happy person. But you should know that what you see on YouTube is not always what's really going on. YouTube is just a show. It just shows a tiny tip of the iceberg of who I am as a person. I have my own struggles and difficulties in life that make it difficult for me to live sometimes. It's shameful, it's sad, I'm trying to work on it. And just want you to know there's also a part of my life that I don't like to share online that much. And for good reason, to be honest. And I'm not trying to say that I'm unhappy. I am not unhappy. I would rate my life, I think, 7 out of 10. I have a pretty good life. But I'm also trying to say that my life is not as perfect as I make it seem on YouTube often. It's my show about butterflies and moths. So I'm not obliged to talk about anything private. This is me doing it out of my own free will. So just know that behind the scenes, even though it looks like I'm doing really well, breeding the rarest species in the world, that behind the scenes there is sometimes struggle and sadness. Not always, thankfully, but sometimes there is. Moments like these make me ashamed, they make me sad. It feels like I'm a bird and I see everyone flying around and I'm trying to flap my wings, but it's not working. Like, I have a broken wing. That's what it feels like, being dysfunctional, really. Time to clean. But hey, you can walk here now, right? You can actually breathe and live here now. It's an improvement if you ask me. Also just the exercise of cleaning it. I will try to keep it clean. Most of the time my room is actually clean. You've just seen me at my worst. So it doesn't look like, it looks like this most of the time. And not like the shocking images you saw earlier, but I guess I just wanted to show you myself at my worst. Wow, ladies and gentlemen, I've actually done it. I have cleaned my room. So I know what some of you are going to be saying, but clearly you are capable of cleaning your room if you want to. It's true, I can. So why am I complaining? Well, if that's the way you think, then you didn't really understand the point I was trying to make, right? What I was trying to show you is how not like, oh, Bart Coppens is too retarded to clean his room, that's not the case. I'm a smart and somewhat functioning individual. Clearly I'm capable of using a vacuum cleaner and taking up my stuff and disposing of it. That's not a problem. The problem is keeping it clean. Now I know what some of you guys are going to say. Well, if you are capable of cleaning your room, why don't you just do it every day? Why don't you every day just sort your stuff and keep it organized? Well, it's difficult to describe the problem to people who don't experience this issue, but that's actually here the fundamental problem, you see. I can organize something, but I cannot consistently keep it organized. Do you know what I'm saying? It's like, it has to do also with like my mental health, right? For me, it's very hard to organize things in such a way that... Man, how do I explain this? It's hard. Okay, think about alcoholism, right? It's possible for people who are alcoholics to maybe not drink alcohol for one day. Maybe it's possible for them to not drink alcohol for a week. But quitting alcohol forever and consistently not drinking for the rest of your life, that's the hard part. It's something like that, but it's also different because obviously alcoholics are addicted, right? And I'm not doing it out of like a compulsion that I'm addicted to making a trashy room, but it's kind of the same. You know, it's being consistent with it that's the issue. If you give me a pile of books, a pile of items, I can arrange them neatly, but it's the action of passively and consistently arranging them every day that's difficult. For me, I have a huge problem with this because my mind is a massive chaos, really. For me, it's very hard to concentrate, to keep track of things. And it also has to do with my mental state. Sometimes I have good days and sometimes I have bad days. And during the good days, sometimes I have the mental fortitude and energy to keep my life organized. But when I'm feeling down or when I get overwhelmed, that's when it's too much for me to arrange. You know, it's too much, and that's when I slip up and neglect to do the things that I should do to take care of myself, and it starts piling up and it becomes a bigger problem and you ignore it. So yeah. That's me trying to explain how this logic works, because you know, it's hard to explain to people on YouTube what it feels like to, you know, be cognitively able to do something, but not consistently, right? I mean, I can clean up my room, but I have a problem with keeping my room clean. But I'm capable of cleaning it, but I have a problem keeping it clean. So clearly I have a problem doing something that I am capable of. And this is really the essence of the question, really. It's the essence of the problem is, I have a problem doing something that I am capable of. So my capability is not limited in performing the said action, but starting to perform the said action, you know? Oh, I see there's a parrot. Hey, Falco, come here, do you wanna come? Oh my God, my parrot just crashed here behind me in my bed. Yeah, sorry for that. You're kind of video bombing me. This is my parrot, by the way. He's in my room. He and me have a pretty nice connection. Huh? Ah. So this is a random moment. It has nothing to do with the subject of this video. This is my parrot, Falco. He's a... Don't be fooled by his cuteness. He's really a dragon in the body of a tiny bird. He is very cute, he is very cuddly, but he can be loud, he can be destructive. And that's because he's a parrot, you know? Parrots are wild animals. They are not domesticated like the cats and dogs. I know people like to say that cats and stuff aren't domesticated, but trust me, this animal has the whole fight and flight response in it if he doesn't like a certain situation. Building trust with a parrot can be difficult. Hey, where are you? What are you doing? Cutie? You're not supposed to be in my video, but go off, I guess. I guess you couldn't help but have the attention. Anyway, you're kind of bombing my video, so why don't you go and go back to your place? Ooh. Oh, that's not the intended effect. Come on, go land somewhere. Yeah, that's not going to work. Come on, go back to your place where you like to hang out. Ooh. There you go. Yeah, you go sit there. It's no problem to me. Silly guy. Anyway, I guess the thing that I really wanted to explain to most of you today is I wanted to... it was very embarrassing to show you the current state of what my room looks like, but I don't want you guys to focus on my room, okay? The problem is not my room. The problem is everything. I have a problem keeping my life consistently organized, right? See, I'm capable of organizing to a certain extent, but I am not capable of organizing everything every day, and sometimes I get overwhelmed. And that's when I start neglecting to do things which should be important for me. So, yeah. And I'm like, how do I explain this to people without seeming crazy, you know? How do I find a good example of where it's difficult to consistently do something that is not difficult, you know? It's the consistently doing something that makes it difficult. It's not the task itself. It's not the cleaning itself that's difficult. It's not the organizing itself that's difficult, but it's the consistently doing it part. So, and that's really difficult for me to convey to some of my viewers. Oh great, my parrot is destroying my Lord of the Rings poster and... Really? My parrot just pulled a freaking poster off the wall. Ah, that's the thing with birds, they're so destructive. Let me fix that. And the thing is, if you have an average neurotypical brain, again, I don't like the word neurotypical and I hate the word neurodiverse. I'll explain that later, why the terminology for me is kind of bad. But it's the best thing that I can do right now. But yeah, if you have like the more average neurotypical brain, or you're not someone who struggles with autism or executive functions, the thing is that you are also doing many of these things more passively, more manually, you know? It's kind of like breathing, right? When you breathe, you and me are constantly breathing. And when we breathe, we don't really think about it. Like, I don't consciously inhale or exhale. It happens almost automatically. Same with blinking. When I blink my eyes, I don't think about it. I don't consciously think, oh, now I have to blink my eyes, you know, to moisturize my eyeballs. And I feel like that's the thing with executive functions that comes with planning, organizing, you know, keeping your stuff organized, but also just planning ahead for the future, learning in time for a certain exam or whatever it is. That's the thing. It feels like I manually have to do things mentally that come more naturally to other people. And that really is for me the issue. It's not that people usually, when their day-to-day life, I know that normal people, for the lack of better words, also have trouble organizing things from time to time. But if you are like me, impaired in your executive functions, it doesn't, it happens way more manually and way less passively. Like, I actively have to go out and spend extra energy on making sure that that I close the door when I leave my house, that I turn the stove off after cooking. Like, for most people, this almost happens instantaneously, but these tiny little details, they just slip my mind if I don't manually think about them. And I don't know. So yeah, that's why it's more difficult, you know, if you catch my drift. I'm really struggling to convey some of these very complex thoughts and concepts in English, which is not my native language, but I hope that you finally understand what it is that I am trying to say here. Most people in their life also have difficulties with the same things that I do, but the thing is, their brain is able to do it, well, more passively, more in a way that is not engaging, right? It happens on the back of your mind. For me, it doesn't. If I don't actively go out and keep things organized, then I don't do it, right? Things will keep piling up. And yeah, stuff like that keeps happening, and that's difficult. Another thing that I really want you guys to understand is that this is not about my room, okay? This is not about me and my room. You see, the reason I chose to show you the room is because the room is just the most obvious way I can give you a visual example of what is wrong with me, right? I can sit here and explain the things that are wrong with me or the things that I struggle with in my daily life. But the thing is, words are just words. And this was for me, even though it was difficult to show it to the people on YouTube, for me, it was the most obvious and the easiest way to give people like something visual to show, like, you know, something tangible. Because like I said, words are just words. I can sit here and talk about my feelings, but maybe it's good for you to see what it's really like and how serious the problem can be. And this is not about my room, because I have the same problem in all the aspects of my life, okay? That room is a visual representation of what's going on inside my head. Like, this is not me complaining that I have a dirty bedroom, no? This is me showing my thought patterns and the fact that from day to day I struggle to organize and plan. And that holds me back professionally. For example, when it comes to having a job, right? If you go to work, it's simple things like consistently showing up to work on time, waking up every day on time, having a daily rhythm, having stability, but also studying, right? When I go to college and I have to like do a test, you have to learn for the test in advance. You have to plan, like, today I will learn chapter 1. This week I will learn chapter 3. This week I will learn chapter 4. And you organize it, you plan out your actions, you follow them. But for me, this is already impossibly difficult, you know? And it's so hard to explain why it's difficult, because this is something that comes naturally to so many people, but it doesn't come naturally to my brain. And that's what it really feels like to me. Things that come naturally to other people don't come naturally to me. This is really the essence of the problem. Like, really simple things that your brain does from day-to-day life are not simple to me, they are hard, they require energy, extra thought, extra effort. I have to put effort into doing basic things, basic human functions that people usually easily perform passively from their day-to-day life. And that's where it stings, right? This is what holds me back. But it's not about a room. This is not about this freaking room, okay? It's not, oh, I'm too retarded to clean up my bedroom. No, it's not about that. Clearly, I can if I want to. It's more about the fact that I am mentally overwhelmed from all the things that you have to do in a day-to-day life. And it doesn't help that my spatial awareness is very low. So when it comes to estimating time, for example, when I was younger, I really had a problem with just estimating time. For example, if you said, Bart, show up here at 1 o'clock, I would show up at 3 o'clock because I misunderstood how long it would take me to travel from my home to my work or from my home to my college. Took me a long time to figure that out. I've gotten better at things, but it's still things like losing my items, losing my passport, you losing my bank cards, losing my identity cards, not being able to consistently show up on time at work, starting projects too early or too late. It's just my mind is a chaos and my life is often a general mess. You know, and that's difficult because I'm passionate. There's many ambitions I have in life. And to be honest, intellectually, in many ways, I am above average intelligent. Even if I say so myself. In some aspects, I'm even gifted. But in other aspects, I'm also really almost disabled. And that sucks because there is... It feels like my brain is wired in a way that it holds itself back instantaneously. Like, before I even... I wish that I could prove myself by committing to something, but I can't, you know? It's not like you try something and you fail. When you try something and you fail, I can accept the results because I gave it my all and I wasn't able to do it. But for me, the problem is even trying, even getting started, right? I mean, imagine running a marathon and you weren't fast enough to be number one because you weren't the fastest runner. I would be okay with that. But to me, it feels I have trouble starting the marathon. I cannot even begin competing. It's the first stage where I fail. And that's frustrating because I feel like I do want to prove myself, you know. Maybe I am a good runner. It's just I have trouble getting started, you know. It's like you have a car with a really fast engine, but you fail to start the car with your car keys. Like there's something wrong with the ignition. That's what it feels like. There's potential. I have certain intelligence that I can use, but I'm prevented from using it in the first place because just, you know, if you suck so much at planning that you start learning for a test 3 days in advance, can you really say that you weren't smart enough to finish the test and get a good grade? Maybe in some way, but it wasn't your intelligence. It wasn't your capability of understanding the substance holding you back. It was the fact that you never really started in the first place. You never really took the opportunity like you were supposed to have it, you know? And that's what stings. That's what makes it bitter, you know? Like, I am someone who I think would be at least intelligent enough to understand college-level biology. But I'm unable to perform well academically or in the workplace, work environment of biology and entomology, which I'm passionate about. Because, not because I'm incapable of understanding it, but because I'm unable to engage with it in the first place, you know? Do you guys understand what I'm trying to say? This is so hard to explain in English. This is a complex feeling that, you know, it's not about the room. It's about how I feel to plan and organize. And this really holds me back from doing just about anything in life, even if I'm good at it. So, yeah. I mean, even if I would be really, really good at cooking, imagine that I'm like super good at cooking food, I would still struggle to become a chef because you would still struggle to show up at the workplace, to be on time. Maybe you would mess up some of the orders, but it's not the cooking that's the problem. It's like the annoying little things around it that are somehow also relevant to it that hold you back, you know? I know I'm talking too much right now, but this is one of those videos where I just wanna vent and give you my thoughts and feelings, and that's what it feels like. You know, it's confusing, it's difficult, it's hard. And in many aspects, it does ruin my life. Like, how do you live with something like this? I'll be honest, I'm sometimes afraid of my future. Like, how do I go on living like this? It's not a problem that can easily be overcome or fixed. I know there's ways that you can learn to live with your problems and relieve some of the symptoms. Stuff like therapy, but it's always going to be there. There's not a medicine that can cure it. There's not a pill I can take to fix my brain. This is how I am. This is how I'm born. And in many ways, I am successful. Some of the stuff I do is pretty unique. I know I brag a little bit, but I'm honest about myself. And I honestly think that in many ways I am talented. But in many ways, there's also massive barriers that are holding me back from achieving the level of success that I would achieve if this stuff didn't hold me back, you know? Like, if I had less problems in my day-to-day life, just doing very simple things, just taking care of myself and being able to work or study better would improve my life so much and would make me so much more successful. But I can't. It's the obstacle, you know? It's really hard. And yeah, I am happy though, just, I mean, just look at my background here. So here's all my moth stuff. I know it doesn't really look super clean or organized, but to me it is. I mean, you've seen what my room looked like before, right? I clean up all the trash from the floor. I know to some of you this still looks like a mess, but one of the problems I think is also I just have too much stuff. And that's one of my other problems, ladies and gentlemen. You see, the moths, they make me in many ways successful. I guess you can say that in many ways I've become famous for what I do with moths. And what the hell did I just do? Did I just pull the rope out of my hoodie because I was fidgeting with it? Oh my God, this is so annoying. Now I have to fix this. Oh great, that's just fantastic. Man, I should stop fidgeting with stuff, that's so annoying. How the hell do I get that back in? Oh well, still works. Sorry, I'm a mess today. Anyway, one of my problems is also my unhealthy obsession with moths. It's hard to let go of it because I managed to monetize it. So now I have to keep going, you know. This YouTube channel makes a little bit money for me, even though it's completely demonetized by YouTube. Thank you, YouTube. That's very kind of you. But still, it generates money. And in some ways, I've made it my job, right? I managed to make the moth stuff my job because I'm good at it. I'm good at talking about it, entertaining people, spreading information. It's my talent. Special talent, but my obsession with these insects is sometimes too much. And I'm going to be honest, this is breeding insects in your bedroom. It's like, sorry for the interruption. I thought it would be funny if I just grabbed a moth from here behind me from the breeding cage. One of them just emerged, a very nice Luna moth. Anyway, I talked about my whole problem with keeping stuff organized and my executive functions and autism and blah. But another part of the problem is also that I really just lack a professional space to breed these insects. Like, it's hard to keep this organized, right? Like, this is just too much stuff. See? One of the problems that I have is, so I managed to monetize my hobby because people like my videos. So I have to keep making them in order to earn money. So I make more and more videos, I breed more and more insects. But it gets to the point where having a business of breeding so many insects in your bedroom is starting to become inappropriate, right? Like, it's okay if you keep a few stick insects and stuff. But 40 moth species per year in your bedroom is starting to become overwhelming. And I think one of the solutions I need for my problems is to have a more professional space to breed these insects as well. It also, like, oh, that was my parrot. Hey, let's take you here. It's okay, you can join us. Come here, mate. Just don't bite me, okay? Yeah, he can bite sometimes. That's what parrots do. He's not aggressive, but he can get anxious. So one of my life goals right now is to have a more professional space to breed my insects. I think that would improve my life dramatically because it means I can keep my stuff more organized. One of the problems with organization that I have is I have a successful channel that requires me to use a ridiculous amount of equipment. But it's not appropriate, right? Like, imagine that you would have to... you have a YouTube channel about stuff like plants or cooking, but you're doing it in your bedroom. And you're building a kitchen in your bedroom, or I don't know. You're growing 20 species of plants in your bedroom. That would become a mess. That's also my situation right now. This place is kind of horrible to keep insects in at this point. I feel like my hobby is outgrowing my house. Another problem is I don't really have climate control for the insects. I think my breeding would dramatically improve if I had a climate controlled space like a greenhouse or even a shed or a laboratory. It would also really improve the quality of my channel. But I'm not in a financial position to afford stuff like that right now, very unfortunately. Otherwise, I just would move all this trash out of my bedroom. But it's the combined fact that I have autism and that I am doing a lot of stuff with a limited amount of space just makes the problem worse. And I don't know how to fix it. The only way how to fix it would be to quit my hobby. Even then, I still have the organizing problem in my mind, but I would have less stuff to deal with. That makes me lose control of the organization and stuff. Like, looking behind me, this is where I breed a lot of insects, see? Like, there's a lot of containers and equipment and stuff. And that's the minimum that I need, right? And in summer, there's even more, because then I deploy the cages for the caterpillars and it just becomes overwhelming. I really, really need a space upgrade. I really need a greenhouse or a shed because this is not sustainable. This is not professional and this is going to ruin my life if I keep going. So I'm already kind of at a breaking point right now of what I'm supposed to be doing. So, but yeah. Anyway, let's not distract too much from the subject at hand, which is autism, but yeah. It plays a role also. Last but not least, I apologize if I was a bit emotional earlier in my video. But the reason I wanted to leave that in and not cut it out of the video because... here's the thing. I can tell you a lot of fancy words. I can tell you how bad it feels to have some of the problems that I do that make my life more difficult. And it does. It is really hard. But those, again, those are just words. But tears. Tears are hard to fake. Tears are genuine. And I can sit here and tell you a lot of stuff, but I think that genuine moment of emotion, it makes it more authentic, you know? I hardly get emotional like that, but it was just a, I don't know, kind of like a low moment, a low point, where I was just fed up and annoyed. So, I don't cry that often, actually. Last time was a few years ago, so it's kind of like a rare moment. It's also why I decided to make this video, because I was feeling so bad, I felt like I wanted to share it with my YouTube audience. So the moment that I am filming this right now is already a few weeks later. I feel better now, don't worry about me. But I actually liked keeping that in. So. Second of all, it's often stigmatized to show vulnerability and I don't know. I think a lot of people who have autism and deal with these shitty issues like me from their day-to-day life, they keep it hidden, like what they feel. And maybe I was like, you know, if I if I share on YouTube, like if I show really raw images of me feeling bad, maybe it will encourage some of these people to also openly share their feelings. And that's some advice that I can give to other people watching this who have a similar problem. Because when I was growing up, I was taught to bottle it up, you know, because it looks weak or stupid or pathetic. But it also prevents you from getting the help or improvement in your life that you actually need. If you hide your problems or deny them, or you deny the emotions that come with them, you know, it's healthy to cry sometimes, if it's warranted. That's what I think. It's healthy to express yourself. And that's what it is. It is expression. It is acceptance of your feelings, you know. I feel a little bit better now at the moment I'm making this video. But from time to time I do get overwhelmed. And before some of you worry about my mental health, there's something I want to say. I'm overall happy, okay? I have a good life. Because it looks kind of bad showing myself like that. And it may cause people to start worrying about me or worrying about what's going on behind the scenes. I have my ups and downs. It's like ebb and flow of the ocean, right? There's moments life is good and moments life is bad. And it's a cycle, it repeats. But for me, the good still outweighs the bad, thankfully. I could have seen myself in a future where that didn't happen. But I'm also very blessed. I'm very privileged. I have a huge audience on YouTube that likes me. That allows me to monetize some of my passions and share them with people. I get to travel the world. I get to study the rarest and coolest insects. I get to pursue my dream. Soon I will even travel to Brazil to do scientific research on butterflies and moths there. It's a big dream of mine. So in many ways I'm privileged. I have two supportive middle-class parents who support me and my lifestyle. That's something many people cannot take for granted. I think people who are of a lower income family don't have the privileges that I do to pursue insect like this, because in many ways I'm still dependent on my parents as well. Therefore I am lucky, I'm blessed, I'm privileged, and I'm happy. I don't suffer depression. I don't think I've never been suicidal, because that's what I really want to get out of the way, okay? It's a very sensitive subject, I know. Me bringing this up, it's dark. Some people struggle with this. But I have never been suicidal. Like, I really enjoy my life. I love it. I wouldn't trade it for anything else. And I am kind of blessed with this ignorant bliss, where I can have a lot of happiness from very simple things, like looking at a moth. Looking at a butterfly or some flowers or just being in nature, it generally does make me intensely happy. Like, it feels like I have like this unlimited supply of happiness that I can always go to if I feel bad. And if I would give my life a rating, it's a 7 out of 10 at the moment. It's actually really great. Things are going well. Soon I will be able to do research. I feel validated as an entomologist. The people who love my videos, you know, give me compliments, give me gifts, donations. I feel loved. You guys make me feel loved. I've learned how to make friends now. My life is improving. My life is good. And it's important for me to tell my viewers, because it would be disingenuous to make my audience feel as if I don't want to live or don't want to go on. That's very dark. I don't want to give you that impression. That's definitely not the case, okay? So don't worry for me in that regard. Despite that, there are difficulties behind the scenes that you don't see on YouTube. There is hardship and there's mental health issues. No, not depression, but yeah, many other things. So there's been a lot of disappointment and frustration for me as well. I just struggle to find my way in life in general. So anyway, let's move on from this subject. So I've shown you the way that autism impacts me personally, but how does autism work? Like, how does it work in the brain? Let me, I feel like I should finally start explaining to you what it is and how it works. So let me show you a little presentation. Welcome everyone to my newest video. Today we are going to talk about autism, or autism spectrum disorder, what it is, how it works, and the way it affects me. Now, I've already talked in this video about how it affects me without explaining what it is precisely, so I think it is an important subject and I can help educate my viewers about it. I know it is a little bit out of the blue, and in one of my unusual uploads, my channel is mainly focused on the biology of butterflies and moths, but I take the creative freedom to upload whenever I want sometimes. In this episode, I am going to 1. Debunk some of the myths and misinformation that surround the condition that is autism. 2. Explain what autism is and how it works. 3. Spread more awareness about autism and the way it may affect people that are close to us. And 4. Perhaps give some advice to friends or parents, as well as people that live with the condition. Please note that I am not a medical expert or a psychologist. If you feel in need of mental health counseling, please make sure to not find help on YouTube. My advice is friendly in nature, but not professional. Don't listen to YouTubers when it comes to your mental health, okay? That's important. Now let's begin. But before we begin, this presentation uses copyrighted photos and illustrations, which I am allowed to do under the Fair Use Law, which allows me to use these images in a transformative and educational way. This video and my whole channel is demonetized and I gain nothing from making this for non-commercial purposes. The Fair Use Law allows me to use these materials. Let's start to the subject, finally. The word autism itself, interestingly, comes from the Greek word autos, which means self. Think of the word automobile, for example, which means self-moving. Some facts. In the developed countries, about 1.5% of children are diagnosed with ASD, this means autistic spectrum disorder, as of 2017. I have sources for all of this, by the way. This is a scientifically informed presentation. I will show you the sources later in this video. Second of all, autism spectrum disorder, ASD, is a developmental disability that can cause significant social, communication, and behavioral challenges that affect how a person communicates and relates to other people and how they experience the world around them. Autism is unlike any other developmental disability in a sense it can structurally define your personality and worldview, since it is ingrained in the very fundamental makeup of your brain. Autism is a disorder of neural information processing. What does this mean? Every time that you get an impression or a stimulus, be it from any of your senses such as your eyes, but also to any thought that you may have in your mind, your brain has to process this information. A disorder of neural information processing basically means that more or less the transmission of signals in the brain exhibits abnormalities. Autism is a highly variable, lifelong neurodevelopmental disorder associated with a combination of genetic and environmental factors. This, in layman's term, means that autism is a disorder that is permanent and irreversibly impacts the development and functioning that arises from causes that are both genetic and environmental. People with autism have a very high variability in neurocognitive functioning. The IQ varies from low to high. The ways in which people with autism learn, think, and problem solve can range from highly skilled to severely challenged. In layman's terms, this means that people with autism can have a wide range of intelligence and functioning, from highly intelligent to mentally handicapped, and anything in between. Some people with ASD need lifelong support, while others can live independently. This is pretty cut and dry, but it means that the symptoms of autism spectrum disorder can vary so strongly per individual that some people may barely notice them at all and can regularly live independent lives, while others may be incapable of functioning in society and require permanent care. Characterized by difficulties with social interaction and communication and by restricted and repetitive behavior, people with autism commonly struggle to properly communicate with peers and may have trouble socializing. Their behaviors and interests tend to be repetitive. Autism in the brain. Autism is a neurodevelopmental disorder. This means that autism arises from an abnormal development of what we call neurons. Neurons is a fancy word for nerve cells, but in this case it means brain cells. It may not surprise you that brain cells, which are the ones we use to think, reason, and process information, are a type of nerve cell. Abnormal development of these cells in the brain are more or less the fundamental cause of autistic spectrum disorder. While brains have a generally similar makeup and functions, each of our brains varies a lot. The brain is much like a fingerprint. It is somewhat unique in each individual. That is why, despite all of us having similar brain, each human has a completely different personality and performs better or worse at varying cognitive functions. The way your brain is wired is often referred to as your neuroautonomy. And interestingly, this very neuroautonomy that defines who we are as a person, what things we are good at, and that basically forms the essence of who we are as an individual. Autism spectrum disorder is a developmental disorder that affects this very neuroautonomy. What this means is that autism is not a mental illness. Autism is a developmental disorder that defines the very core of our being, that is deeply ingrained and intertwined with our personalities and worldview. Autism is not an illness that prevents certain parts of your brain from functioning properly. Instead, autism is something that defines the very makeup, the very shape of your brain in the first place, and therefore defines who you are down to your very core. Let's get technical. This right here is a brain cell. The axon, which is a long extension of a nerve cell, takes information away from the cell body. Bundles of axons are known as nerves, or within the CNS, the central nervous system, as nerve tracts or pathways. Dendrites bring information to the cell body, while axons take it away. Myelin coats and insulates the axon, except for periodic breaks, called nodes of Ranvier, increasing transmission speed along the axon. Myelin is manufactured by Schwann cells and consists of 70 to 80% lipids or fats and 20 to 30% protein. For the record, for the people who cannot follow this, I'm talking about the coating that coats the extension of the nerve cell. The cell body or soma contains the neuron's nucleus with DNA and typically nuclear organelles, and dendrites branch from the cell body and receive messages. So important to note here is that the axon transmits messages away from the cell while the dendrites receive them. So axon is information out, dendrite information coming in. And then there's the synapses, which are relevant to this video. A typical neuron has about 1,000 to 10,000 synapses. That is, it communicates with 1,000 to 10,000 other neurons, muscle cells, glands, etc. They are very interconnected. A synapse is the gap between the axon terminal and the receiving cell. While dendrites and axons receive or transmit, the actual transmission of information between cells is transferred through the synapses. Therefore, the synapse is crucial when it comes to neurotransmission. How do these synapses function? Well, today I am not going to explain this in detail since this video is about autism and not a video about neurobiology. Maybe we'll do that some other time. However, important for you guys to understand is that at the synapse, the cells can transmit electrical and chemical signals. A synapse is a junction between two nerve cells, consisting of a minute gap across which electrochemical impulses can pass. They are important because it is the connections across synapses that form the networks that are thought by neuroscientists to comprise thoughts and consciousness. Why am I telling you all of this? Because new studies suggest that autistic people may have a surplus of synapses. Curiously, this means that brain cells have an abundance of connections through which information is transferred through cells. And this is what can lead to miscommunication. Too many synaptic connections disrupt communication within the brain, which could be at the root of autism. In the words of Azad Bonney, the head of the neuroscience department at the Washington University School, You may think that having more synapses would make the brain work better, but that doesn't seem to be the case. An increased number of synapses creates miscommunication among neurons in the developing brain that correlates with impairments in learning, although we don't know how. It seems that interestingly, even science has not gotten to the bottom of autism yet. One fact is that many specific autism-specific genes happen to be genes that regulate the number of synaptic connections in the brain. Connections persist for more extended periods than they do in the brains of neurotypical individuals. New research takes a look at what happens in the brain and how that relates to a person's ability to tolerate exposure to various stimuli. Thanks to the functional magnetic resonance imaging scans that scientists made, the researchers were able to perform that in the brains of people with autism, connections persist for more extended periods than they do in the brains of neurotypical individuals. Or in other words, in autism, the brain finds it harder to switch between processes, and older processes persist for longer. Autism spectrum disorder is caused by changes in how the developing brain wires itself up, such as in genetic instructions, genotypical, or risk factors during pregnancy or early in development, phenotypical. Autism seems to be a combination of genetic factors and environmental factors that affect neural development, including advanced age, in either parent, diabetes, bleeding or use of psychiatric drugs, in the mother during pregnancy, maternal inflammatory and autoimmune diseases, and anything that can aggravate genetic problems in a developing baby. So, to summarize this, autistic spectrum disorders and the abnormal development of the brain that creates this disorder happens in the womb, when the brain is still forming. Several things can go wrong when your brain is still developing, when you are a baby in your mother's womb. And the things that can go wrong can be genetic in nature, but it can also be inflammation, other diseases, diabetes, advanced age in parents, etc. So that's a lot of factors combined. Brains of people with autism spectrum disorder have more nerve cell structures called dendritic spines, which receive signals from other nerve cells. Abundance of connections leads to neural miscommunications. So that all sounds complicated, so let's make it simple for you guys. Here is a massive oversimplification, which even my dumbest, most dim-witted fans will understand. I'm sorry, I'm not here to make fun of you. But this here is John. Hi, John. John wants to make a hamburger, but he forgot a recipe. So he is calling his mother. You see, his mother is a great cook and will gladly share with John all the ingredients he needs to make a good hamburger. As you can see, the ingredients are a bun, lettuce, a beef patty, cheese, tomato, and onions. So John calls up his mom and she answers the phone. John's mom shares the ingredients with him, telling him exactly what to do and what to make. Problem solved. John's mom told him to make a hamburger with a bun, lettuce, a beef patty, cheese, tomato, and onions. John received the information he wanted by calling his mom. But what would happen if John had autism? Let's see what happens if John makes the call. He is very hungry and he wants to make a hamburger. John's mom answers the phone. And so does his girlfriend, and his uncle, and his son. They are all talking to him simultaneously. John's mom tries to explain the ingredients to him, but John's girlfriend keeps nagging him that he should order a salad instead because he eats unhealthy hamburgers. John's mom tells him that he needs a bun and a beef patty and onions, but at the same time, John's uncle starts to tell him he should add peanut butter, fish sauce, and shrimp to make a great curry. John's son starts crying because he shit himself and his diaper is full, while John is angry because he found out his girlfriend had an OnlyFans account and was selling nudes behind his back to make profit. John's mom is talking about McDonald's now and that she should order chicken nuggets. Wait, what? Hamburgers? Oh, we forgot why he called. John's uncle brags about his newest Tinder matches, not realizing he was catfished by an FBI agent pretending to be an underage girl online. John hangs up the phone. Did he get everything that he needed? John's hamburger is a failure because he did not pay attention to the ingredients, because he got an overload of information. He only needed to know about a bun, a lettuce, a beef patty, cheese, tomato, and onions. But instead, he received an overdose of information that he did not need. John messed up. It was a miscommunication, and now he has to eat a disgusting hamburger. I know that what you just saw was a little bit silly and over the top. But this was a perfect metaphor of what happens in the brains of people with autism and why they can be prone to sensory overloads. An abundance of connections in the brain leads to miscommunication and failure when it comes to mobilizing and processing information in the brain. This gives rise to the complications that we describe as the symptoms of autism. So, I represented this by making it a metaphor for a phone line. Imagine calling somebody on the phone, but instead of calling the person you wanted to call, there's five other people on the line simultaneously talking to you. That would also represent an overabundance of connections that you don't need, causing miscommunication. Autism still poses many mysteries to science. This video was made in 2020. It could be that in 10, 15 or in 20 years all the information here is outdated. I'm just a YouTuber, not a neuroscientist, however it is clear that autistic brains show connectivity differences. The neurobiology is not well understood, and it seems that there is a degree of underconnectivity between distant brain regions and overconnectivity between neighboring ones. Connections persist for too long. Autism's diversity also makes it hard to research. So the result is that too much information is mobilized, potentially leading to overstimulation or sensory overload. Autistic people perceive the world differently. There is overconnectivity between distant brain regions. Overly persistent brain connections can lead to the fact that people with autism do not like unexpected stimuli, and maybe because brains are not as efficient at rapidly shifting between ideas or thoughts. Let's look at the repetitive patterns of behavior, interests, and activities that include signs of autism that a child or an adult with autism spectrum disorder may exhibit. Behavioral. Performs repetitive movements such as rocking, spinning, or hand flapping. Performs activities that could cause self-harm such as biting or headbanging. Develops specific routines or rituals and becomes disturbed at the slightest change. Has problems with coordination or has odd movement patterns such as clumsiness or walking on toes, or has odd, stiff, or exaggerated body language. Is fascinated by details of an object, such as the spinning of wheels of a toy car, but doesn't understand the overall purpose or function of the object. Is unusually sensitive to light, sound, or touch, yet may be indifferent to pain or temperature. Doesn't engage in imitative or make-believe play. Fixates on an object or activity with abnormal intensity or focus. Oops, I'm guilty of that one. Has specific food preferences, such as only eating a few foods or refusing foods with a certain texture. A child or adult with autism spectrum disorder may have problems with social interaction and communication skills. Now, socially, here are a few things they may have problems with. For example, fails to respond to his or her name or appears to not hear you at times. Resists cuddling and holding and seems to prefer playing alone, retreating into his or her own world. Has poor eye contact and lacks facial expression. Doesn't speak or has delayed speech or loses previous ability to say words or sentences. Can't start a conversation or keep one going, or only starts one to make requests or label items. Speaks with an abnormal tone or rhythm, and may use a sing-song voice or robot-like speech. Repeats words or phrases verbatim, but doesn't understand how to use them. Doesn't appear to understand simple questions or directions. Doesn't express emotions or feelings and appears to be unaware of others' feelings. Doesn't point at or bring objects to share interest. Inappropriately approaches a social interaction by being passive, aggressive, or disruptive. Has difficulty recognizing nonverbal cues such as interpreting other people's facial expressions, body postures, or tone of voice. Autistic people may find it hard to communicate and interact with other people. Autistic people may find it hard to understand how other people think or feel. Autistic people may find things like bright lights or loud noises overwhelming, stressful, or uncomfortable. Autistic people may get anxious or upset about unfamiliar situations and social events. Autistic people may take longer to understand information. Last but least, autistic people may do or think the same things over and over. Autistic people can have any level of intelligence, and because of this, it's very hard to generalize. Autistic people can vary from the greatest scientist to people that are so developmentally stunted that they can but sit in a wheelchair or barely go outside. This sounds harsh, but it's completely true. Do not generalize us. We have a whole spectrum of intelligence just like you. Some people with autism are exceptionally intelligent, and some of them are mentally disabled. How else can you recognize autism? Are you concerned that one of your friends could be autistic? Here are some clues. Although once again, please be careful with diagnosing other people because this is very generalized. But autistic people, especially if you want to recognize it in somebody else, may be finding it hard to understand what others are thinking or feeling, or getting very anxious about social situations, finding it hard to make friends, or preferring to be on your own, and seeming blunt, rude, or not interested in others without meaning to be rude, that is. Finding it hard to say how you feel. Taking things very literally. For example, you may not understand sarcasm or phrases like break a leg. Having the same routine every day and getting anxious if it changes. Not understanding social rules, such as not talking over people. Or avoiding eye contact. Getting too close to other people, or getting very upset if someone touches or gets too close to you. Noticing small details, patterns, smells or sounds that others do not. Having a very keen interest in certain subjects or activities. And liking to plan things carefully before doing them. Is there any treatment for autism? Well, yes and no. Important to understand, there is no cure for autism. And most individuals with autistic spectrum disorder will need support and services throughout their lifetime. Any sources promoting or selling a cure to autism are fraudulent. If you paid attention to my video, you'll have realized that autism affects the very anatomy of your brain, which is not something that can just be changed. Any sources telling you that there is a cure for autism are frankly a scam. There is no cure. However, therapy can relieve some of the symptoms to a certain extent. To this extent that they may possibly, not to the extent that they are cured, but to the extent that a person may learn to live with them in more efficient ways. The most effective treatments, which I quote, are today applied behavioral analysis and occupational speech and physical therapy, which have proven to be the most effective. Now then again, people, I am a YouTuber, I am not a doctor. I'm giving you recommendations and my opinion, and I'm trying to make a scientifically informed video. But if you need any help with your mental health and functioning in society, please make sure to go to a professional and don't just take advice from a YouTuber. I'm confident in what I'm saying right now, but also I don't just want people to use this video as a consult. But yes, there is therapy for it available. No, there is no cure. In many areas of life, and particularly healthcare, men are seen as the standard, and women suffer as a result, as it is assumed that female bodies function in the same way. If you are a woman, pay attention, because this may be an important issue for you. Autism spectrum disorder is identified in females at a substantially lower rate than in males, with most epidemiological studies approximately reporting a 4-to-1 male-to-female ratio. On the surface level, it appears as if autism is somewhat rare in women and common in men. This may take some people to believe that autism is perhaps mostly a male disorder. However, this would be very misleading. Autism is more common among men than women, but women are also underdiagnosed or diagnosed at a much later age. This occurs because girls and women appear to be better at camouflaging their symptoms and imitating neurotypical behaviors. It is also the case that girls' symptoms go unrecognized because of cultural norms and stereotypes. Girls with autism are more likely than boys to have comorbidities such as anxiety, anorexia, and obsessive-compulsive disorders. The difference may result from using gold standard diagnostic tools that seem to be more appropriate for boys than for girls. It seems likely that many girls with autism do not receive accurate diagnosis until much later than boys. Some are not diagnosed until adulthood, despite having autism symptoms since early childhood. Also important to know is autism was first discovered in men. And from that moment, the way it was described and years of research upon those associated symptoms are based on a male-centric model. For the entomologist among us watching this, it's kind of like describing a new species of moth based on specimens of the males, not realizing that females may have a different appearance. And when they show up, you'd not recognize them as the same species, while in reality they are. Girls are more likely to internalize anxiety related to autism too, for example, instead of behaving aggressively. They are more likely to become depressed or antisocial. Most cultures make it acceptable for a girl to be very shy, whereas shyness is less acceptable in a boy, which leads boys to get diagnosed much earlier. When girls with autism focus exclusively on a particular interest, they are more likely than boys to choose a socially acceptable fascination such as unicorns or dolls. I wonder if any of you are watching this who are also into moths like me and autistic and female. If so, leave a comment. I'd like to hear your story. Anyway, because fewer females seem to have autism, fewer females with autism have also been included in studies. More attention is now being paid to how autism manifests in girls and women. For women worldwide, it's important for you to be aware of this. If you are a woman with autism, your condition may be more understood than that of males with autism, and you may have to put up more effort into getting appropriately diagnosed. So one of the things that I would like to do with this video is spread awareness for women, and in particular women with autism, because they may be at a disadvantage here. So right now I am going to tell you some symptoms of autism or experiences that women or girls with autism commonly share. Now, of course, every girl and woman with autistic spectrum syndrome, every girl and woman with autism spectrum syndrome is of course unique. But they may share certain experiences, and some of these particular experiences are more common in females with autism spectrum syndrome than in men. And I'm going to read some of them. So according to the Asperger or Autism Network, a girl or a woman with autism spectrum syndrome may know that she is different, noticing that her interests veer away from those of her peers, may avoid interacting with them. So it seems that a girl or a woman with autism is more likely to be self-aware that her interests don't really align with the average person's interests and may actively avoid interacting with others more, being more self-conscious with their interests. A girl or woman with autism may prefer having only one or two friends or play in solitude, having an appreciation and focus on specific interests. A girl or a woman with autism may demonstrate an aversion to what is popular, what is feminine, or what is fashionable. A girl or a woman with autism may be sensitive to textures, and she may instead prefer to wear what is comfortable and practical instead of what looks good. A girl or woman with autism may appear naive or immature as she is out of sync with the trends or social norms. A girl or woman with autism may work very hard to camouflage her social confusion or anxiety through strategic imitation, by escaping into nature, hey, or fantasy, by staying on the periphery of social activity. A girl or woman with autism may be more inclined to show different sides of her personality in different things or different settings. A girl or woman with autism may be more prone to releasing her bottled up emotions at home, through meltdowns, for example. A girl or woman with autism may be exhausted from the work of deciphering social rules or of imitating those around her to hide her differences. A girl or woman with autism may be more likely to be anxious in settings where she is asked to perform in social situations. This could lead to mutism, or just not saying much, escapism, or a focus on routines or rituals. Now, of course, many of the symptoms I just read can be found in men who have autism too, but seem to be more prevalent in women. And the reason for that is because there is a theory that women are naturally better at camouflaging themselves socially and adapting to social situations. Now, this may have a neurologic origin. The thing is, male and female brains do have differences, although, of course, these differences are often grossly overstated. In terms of intelligence, for example, the male and female brain is more or less the same. But women, for example, have more mirror neurons. Mirror neurons are, they play a role in mimicking or interpreting other people's behaviors, and maybe even things like empathy to some extent. So differences in a manifestation of autistic traits have lent support to the theory of camouflaging in autistic women, which suggests that women are able to mask socio-communicative impairments due to increased sensitivity to social pressure to fit in, gendered expectations for social behavior, and strength in some social communication skills. Now, of course, what also may play a role is the expectation that our society and culture may have of women, and that they differ. And maybe it's more unacceptable for a woman not to conform to social norms than for a man, or there may be more social pressure for women than for men, which leads to autistic women putting more effort in camouflaging themselves and their symptoms. So it's not all in the brain, it is also cultural. And actually, our gender norms and standards may play a role in this as well. So this is particularly common among females at the high functioning end of the autistic spectrum. And for example, common forms of camouflaging, they can include forcing yourself to make eye contact during conversations, preparing jokes or phrases ahead of time to use in conversation, mimicking the social behavior of others, and imitating the expressions and gestures of others. While both males and females with autism can camouflage their symptoms, it appears to be more common among women and girls. So this could explain why women are less likely to be diagnosed with autism. And that, my friends, is actually a shame, because everybody who has a condition deserves to get treatment for it and to have an accurate diagnosis. Bart Coppens speaking out for women? Oh my god, he must be a simp. He must be trying to get on the good side of his fangirls and score social progressiveness points. All seriousness aside, if women or girls are watching this, it is important. The science is pretty clear on this. And the truth is that if you have a condition that makes your life more difficult, it doesn't really matter what gender you are, right? You want to get treated and diagnosed. You want to get help. You want to make your life easier. And the truth is, when it comes to medical science, is that, that men are often seen as the standard. Especially when you go back in time, you know, where the history of psychology and neurology, a lot of the developmental disorders, for example, were first discovered in male patients, were described based on male patients, not realizing that the symptoms may be different in females and women, right? So when you use these diagnostic tools based on, well, when you describe something you are unfamiliar with based on male patients, the diagnostic tools may be more centered to symptoms that males exhibit. I'm struggling a little bit because this is complex subject matter and my native language is not English. I'm talking about neurology, psychology with my terrible accent and limited English vocabulary. But simple truth is that the diagnostic tools to diagnose women with autism perhaps have a lot of shortcomings, and maybe it could even be that some of the symptoms that come with autism for women are less commonly known or underrepresented. So that sucks. I mean, you deserve to get accurately diagnosed. You deserve to get help. And it could be that if you are a woman or a girl with autism, you may not get taken seriously, right? You may get brushed aside. Or maybe there is a doctor who really doesn't think out of the box. Or when medical science is really just focusing on diagnosing you based on behavior, that's the problem, right? Autism can only be diagnosed behaviorally. So when it's based on behavior, and when males and females are known to present different behaviors and different symptoms when it comes to the same developmental disorder, you can see why when males have been the standard for so long, women may get misdiagnosed. So if you are a woman or a girl with autism, it could be that is actually hard for you to get diagnosed with autism. While you are autistic, you have autism, you have autism spectrum syndrome. You struggle with it, but you may actually not receive the diagnosis that you need. And that, my friends, is problematic, right? So, I know some people will probably find it funny to hear me talk about social issues, but it is a social issue and it's real. So, I don't know, I just wanted to put it in, because it's kind of important, and it's also interesting because it means that maybe we really don't know everything about autism yet, and we don't know everything about the human brain either. We certainly don't know everything in the way that, for example, people with a different gender may exhibit different behaviors. But also the way how these behaviors and cognitions may be affected by developmental disorders and may show different symptoms. It also seems that women generally, of course this is a generalization, right? Every individual is unique, but we are just talking about millions of people, like generalized. So our brains are like a fingerprint, all of them are unique. But generally speaking, there are tiny differences in the brain of women compared to men, which may be, for example, a heightened sensitivity to social problems, a heightened sense of empathy due to having more mirror neurons in the brain. So it turns out maybe actually women experience many of the symptoms that men with autism do, but they are way, way better at camouflaging them, at hiding them away. And that's not really a good thing, because the only way to diagnose autism is based on behavior. And if you camouflage the behavior, if you mask the behavior, if you mask the symptoms, then maybe a doctor or a psychologist may say, well, it doesn't add up, because the diagnostic tools say something different compared to your behavior, because you are masking the symptoms. And I believe about 1 in 4 people with autism spectrum syndrome right now are men. So that's something interesting to think about. If you are a woman or a girl with autism, you're watching this right now, I would like to hear your experience. I know it's very personal, just write it in the comments, but only if you're comfortable with sharing it. Because it is something that needs more research. And I think it also helps just to make more people aware of that fact, you know? Because if people have this stereotype about autism that maybe isn't true for women at all, and people aren't even aware of it, because hey, the average person doesn't read about autism. The average person is not interested in developmental disorders, right? Like, ask the average person about autism and how it works in the brain. They don't care. They just have like the stereotype of what what depression or autism or ADHD or what it is. But in reality, it's rarely accurate. Like, we have these Hollywood stereotypes of disorders and illnesses that are actually very inaccurate. And when we have this stereotype of autism, that is perhaps an inaccurate stereotype for men, but maybe a 10 times more inaccurate stereotype for women, that leads to women not getting the help that they need in the first place. And that's fucked up because, you shouldn't have a medical disadvantage just for being born a certain way. I know, very progressive. Oh, Bart Coppens, you're a hero. Just wanted to point it out, guys. I'm not trying to score social credits, alright? But hey, let's be real. I could have been born a woman. Everybody could have. It's life is a lottery. All of us could have been any race or any gender. I just happen to be a person in the Netherlands who is male and Caucasian. Maybe you are... I don't know where you live. Maybe you are ethnically Chinese, but you were born in Russia, or maybe you're Australian or Brazilian. Who cares? You know, it's life is a combination of probability, and you shouldn't have medical disadvantage just because you ended up in a category of probability that people care less about, because that's the truth. There's less research being done on women and female brains because autism is more rare in women, so less women have been used in studies because there's less data, etc., etc. So yeah, awareness. It's important, people. Anyway, I'm a man, so I guess many of those things don't apply to me. But hey, this video is for everyone, not just for people who are like me. So I could talk for hours about autism and the neurology and the science behind it, because it's highly interesting and fascinating, but it's already an extremely long video. Yeah, this is one of the longest ever. But now I've told you some of the symptoms, including, for example, preoccupations. Now, what's funny is many of the symptoms of autism, some of them are really not prevalent in me. I'm highly extroverted. I'm very sociable, approachable, some ways empathic. So like the social problems that many people have with autism, you don't really see them that much in me. I do have the repetitive behavior and narrow interest. And that's what I really want to talk about now, because I explained what autism is, but the video is also about me. So we're shifting from the personal experience to explaining what it is, back to the personal experience. One of the strongest ways autism has infected my life is the extreme obsession with insects, like the extreme preoccupation that I have. Like, I'm obsessed with butterflies and moths, always have been since I was very young. And I'm going to talk about it now in the preoccupation chapter. Let's go. Thank you. to be continued in part 2. Before you draw any conclusion about me and my life, make sure to watch all the parts of this series in a chronological order. Otherwise, you may have drawn your conclusion too early. This is actually one very long video, broken up into smaller parts to make it more digestible and watchable for viewers. Please make sure to watch part 2 of this series to understand the full scope of everything I am trying to say, and to draw an accurate conclusion, because if you only watch this and not the rest, you may not get the full picture of what's going on. Yes, this series has a nice conclusion, a conclusion that you should be able to reach by watching all the parts of this series. Chapter 3, Preoccupation, continues there, and I hope to see you in the next video where we discuss more.